Morning, everyone. I'm Beth Riley. I'm with NCDSS. I'm the Child Welfare Eligibility and Compliance Manager. We are going to be going over day sheet claiming and coding for child welfare services. And I am going to be doing this with Caleb. So I'll let Caleb introduce himself.
Hey, I'm Caleb Hawkins. I'm with DSS2. I am the interim lead local business liaison, and the LBL team and Beth's 4E team have partnered together to do this presentation.
Next slide. So before we get started, we want to kind of go over a few questions that we have. And We've done this presentation a few times at SSI, and this is the second time we've done it as a webinar. So if you would type in the chat, because you can't all answer, when you think about day sheets, who does day sheets? How do you feel about the day sheets, and why do we have day sheets? So give you a few minutes to kind of type in the chat, see what you think. So when activities are funded by one or more federal funds, it is a federal requirement to accurately account for time spent for activities. So that is why those social workers, they keep day sheets. Some supervisors keep day sheets. We have them in order to account for time, in order for us to be able to claim funding for the agencies, for DSS, to appropriately fund services and activities. A lot of feedback that we get from counties when we ask, how do you feel about day sheets? A lot of times we hear it's painful. Why do we have to do them? A lot of folks don't like day sheets. So we understand, we hear that a lot. So just wanted to kind of get that ball rolling as to why we do day sheets, why do we keep them, and how do folks feel about them?
So day sheets serve as the basis for county reimbursement, and to be an allowable charge and for the county to be reimbursed, charges have to be accurate, allowable, and properly allocated. They have to reflect all the activity the employee is paid for, including any non-federal, so that's state or county funded activity. And they have to support the distribution of the employee's salary and wages among specific activities if the employee works on more than one federal award. And certainly in child welfare, there's multiple funding sources. So this is pretty vital. North Carolina uses what is called 100% time reporting. So if you are staff, you do day sheets, you know you have to report your whole day in down to 5 minute increments. And that is very cumbersome. And North Carolina is the only state that uses 100% time reporting anymore. We are currently in the process of moving to a replacement system that will use either random moment time sampling or a hybrid random moment time sampling and direct time reporting model. This is a big project for the state, and it takes a while to procure IT and get all the federal approvals. So the current target date for that implementation is 2027. So why do we keep day sheets? It's not just busy work. The primary purpose is to compute percentage of time spent by staff in the delivery of direct service time. And like I said, this serves as the basis for county reimbursement. It provides documentation along with the case record to support reimbursement. So theoretically, any time that a worker bills to a direct service activity, the feds or a monitor or your single county auditor could ask to see the day sheet, see the case record to make sure that claim was valid. It provides information to determine the cost of services provided, It enables more effective planning and budgeting, both at the county and the state level, provides a source of recipient counts for program management, and it provides an audit trail for services. And so, like we said, it's important to accurately report day sheets because it's provides us more accurate records. You avoid monitoring and audit findings. You're going to have fewer paybacks. You'll be able to better track the services used by your clients in your county, and it helps you plan for budget and service delivery.
So what would you say are the biggest day sheet challenges? I'll give you guys a couple of seconds to type in the chat what you see as your biggest challenges. Knowing what code to use, timely coding, time consuming. And these are some of the things that are popping up in the chat. Not knowing what to do. All right, Jay, can you progress the slide? So some of the common things that we've seen, common answers, is not understanding coding, not having enough time to do day sheets, forgetting what you did, waiting until the end of the month to report time, and the best code or code combinations today can be incorrect tomorrow, especially in child welfare. As you probably all are very aware, when you're dealing with Title IV-E versus, you know, children who are in foster care, if you have a child that's Title IV-E, they could potentially come out of eligibility status for that 4E payment for different reasons. So we're gonna kind of dive into some of these things and look at our coding and the codes that we use in child welfare. So how would you say that we address the challenges that we're facing? And I'll give you guys another minute, couple of seconds to kind of type in. How do you feel like we should, how do we address these things? Knowing what code to use, using correct codes. All right, Jay, if you'll progress it for me. So if completing day sheets daily could really help with the challenge of doing day sheets and getting them accurate, having supervisors to review the entries that workers are entering, days falling in the last calendar week of the month should be reviewed and sent for keying by the first working day of the next month, and then utilizing the SIS manual. I mean, that's really helpful to look at the SIS manual. And even with that, though, I know that some of those definitions don't make sense or you don't understand them. It's great. So that's where you can talk with your physical staff at your agency, getting an understanding of what funding sources are available. And then if you still have questions, you're still unsure what code do we use, you can always contact a state person to find out what is appropriate.
So with day sheets, I think I saw somebody put in the chat that understanding the alphabet soup. So there are a lot of acronyms, and I'm just going to go over some of the funding sources real quick. So the first are MOE and TANF, and that's Maintenance of Effort and Temporary Assistance for Needy Families in North Carolina. Those are called our Work First program. There's also TEA, Temporary Emergency Assistance, which confusingly is also TANF. There's 4E, and that's the main federal fund for foster care. There's SFHF, that's state foster home funding, and there's SSBG, that's your social services block grant, which gets spread around to a lot of different areas. The important thing to understand in child welfare is that not all the funds are the same. And specifically, there are capped funds, which are quarterly or yearly allocations, and once you reach the limit on that, your county's limit, any spending, any time coded to that will come out of your county budget, your county dollars. And that makes using your uncapped funds very important. And unfortunately, in child welfare, 4E is pretty much the only uncapped fund. So like I said, 4E is the largest uncapped funding source. The largest cap funding source is TANF. So even though we think of Work First a lot of times as a income maintenance program, TANF funds a lot of different things. And in North Carolina, a big thing it funds is child welfare. Then there's multiple smaller SSBG and state funding sources. And funding for your state foster children is capped. So most counties, if you have a lot of state foster children, you're gonna exhaust your available funding for your staff time. And that's partially why it's so critical to complete eligibility determinations within the set timeframes so that you can make sure you're using the correct code and not drawing down funding from sources you don't need to be. So just a real quick thing on Work First. Work First or TANF is a block grant, and it's a little unique in that it has a required county match called maintenance of effort. So if you do day sheets, maintenance of effort, MOE, that is your non-code. Your federal Work First, which you actually get reimbursement for, is R. And you're supposed to be, counties are legislatively required to meet their MOE goal each year. And failure to meet the county's goal can result in audit findings or even loss of federal TANF funds. Now, due to declining Work First caseload, the main way counties meet MOE these days is by coding 210 and 211 services to 9. If your county is having trouble meeting MOE, one thing you could explore is establishing MOE eligibility for your non-4E, your state foster kids, after your TANF to SSBG funds have been exhausted.
So let's talk about eligibility versus reimbursability in child welfare. So when a child enters care, that's when the initial eligibility is determined by the child's status, how they come into custody. We also looking at need and deprivation, and this is how this is where you're documenting the eligibility status on the 5120. So that's where that comes into play when you have a child that enters foster care. Reimbursability is determined by where the child is placed. So it's not accurate if you have a child who is 4E eligible to say if that child is now placed in a unlicensed kinship placement that they're no longer 4E. The child has not lost their eligibility. They are not eligible to be claimed to 4E. So the reimbursability has changed. So understanding the difference, I think, can help folks understand how you should claim for these children in care. And then also understanding that your ongoing eligibility is determined by obtaining required court findings for permanency. So you're looking at that reasonable efforts language in your court orders to make sure that the court has found that DSS has made reasonable efforts towards whichever permanency plan has been identified. The requirements for need and deprivation are no longer required for that ongoing eligibility because that is established at the beginning, and you do not need to reestablish that unless that child leaves care. If they exit care and then they come back in, then that's a new entry and a new 5120 would be required at that point. So we're going to kind of walk through our program codes that we use in child welfare. We're going to start at the beginning with intake. So with intake, that is program code or service code 211 with program codes of 9, 0, and R. And Caleb's already mentioned about 9, which is maintenance of effort. Typically, this is what is used first. And this is, like he mentioned before, how counties can get their MOE met in order to draw down their TANF funding. If a county has met their MOE and they have TEA money available to use, they can use zero. If they have no zero money, then they can use R. So 210 is assessments and investigations, same coding here as far as R0 and 9. And for TEA, R and 0 eligibility is already established. So that means the child is in crisis, that you've met that by this being an investigation, you're mandated. There's not an eligibility verification form like a 5120. For Work First Block Grant MOE, you would use 9. And so all MOE eligibility must be met. MOE cannot be used to fund all CPS investigations. So understanding which ones would be applicable to MOE. If eligible for MOE, you would use the same fiscal sequence as described in 211. So here's where we get a little bit more into our program codes, the alphabet soup, as Evan likes to coin it. How do we know which ones to use, right? So we have, this is where we're throwing in top 4E into the mix. So we have Z, which is 4E, R and 0, which are TEA, TANF, non-MOE. X is SSBG, which is a new introduction to another new code. And then we have N, which is non-payment. And you don't want to use N if you can help it. Sometimes N is required. You don't have a choice. But in this sequencing, we do not like to kind of use risk assessments as the basis for determining candidacy or whether or not you can use Title 4E, because risk assessment alone does not drive candidacy. And I just want to make sure that folks understand that, because I think our current manual does speak to candidacy and speaks to risk assessments, and it's currently in revision now. And understanding that if you have a low risk score, that doesn't mean the child may not be a candidate, and it may require that a supervisor or a second level, you know, party look at that risk assessment, because risk assessment is determined by many factors. So I just want to make sure that we're clear on that. You have to establish TEA eligibility to use R and 0. And you have to establish MOE eligibility in order to use 9. So you can look in the manual, the Appendix 3.4 in the Child Welfare Funding Manual. It will give you the steps on how to establish these things. SSBG funds are used for those cases where the child's not a candidate, you may not be able to use TEA or MOE. So that would be kind of the, like your other resort to use, which state block grant funds. With X, we really don't like to use that in child welfare, because that's typically an adult services code and they do not have the same type of funding sources that we have in child welfare. So if you can avoid using it, that's good, but sometimes you just can't. Then we have N, which is non-reimbursable, and then the last one is Title 4E, which is Z, and you have to have the completed documentation in order to establish candidacy for the child. And what that looks like is you have to have a completed case plan with the family with imminent risk statements for that child. And so it can't be that you have established the case plan, you've already documented the plan, and you're going to get signatures for the family. From the family, that's not how this works. You actually have to sit down, come up with the plan based off of the needs and services that need to be established for that family and that child, and you have to document an actual statement within the plan that the child, you know, without these interventions, that this child would be at risk for entering foster care. So we have 109, which is foster care services, and very similar program codes to what I mentioned earlier, but we do have some new ones to throw in here, which we have P and V, I think, are the newest ones to throw into this mix. P, which is for permanency, and then V is the SSBG. So V and X a lot of times are interchanged. And again, we really encourage to go with V because that's the child welfare code. And those are for those state-funded kids. So that's the coding. And I'm not to say that's the end-all be-all coding for state-funded kids. But if you have a child that is in a non-reimbursable placement or a child who is established to be SFHF, that's typically going to be your code that you're going to use for those kids. There are times where permanency planning or P may be appropriate early on into a case. If you have not run out of time under TEA, so which that is 364 days, you can still use TEA for those children who are not 4E. So that's the thing, is if they're 4E, you got to go with 4E, or you should go with 4E, unless the child is in a non-reimbursable placement, and then you have to go with some other funding. And then you have 9, which is MOE. And so if you do go with TEA, then you must establish eligibility. You have to determine eligibility, which is the last page, I believe, or it may be second to last page on the 5120. You would need to complete that and have that in the file for the child. Adoptions, for those cases that are in foster care, you would open up 009 for those children, and that those program codes would be the same as what you had in 109. So if you've established eligibility for this child, the child's Title 4E eligible, then you're going to use Z. Unless you have a situation where the child is in a non-reimbursable placement. And then you would also keep in mind that using Z is for case management activities, not for services. 010 is for adoption services, and these are those adoptions that the child may not be in DSS custody. So the child may have left care, being adopted later by grandparent or step-parent adoption. That's where you would use this program code, and if the agency is being paid for that service, then it would not be appropriate to use anything other than N. If it's a situation where the child left care, agency is now back involved in the sense of just the adoption, then you would want to look at probably claiming to, you know, V or R or P or something like that. But you would need to look at the definitions in order to make sure that it is appropriate, because some situations, like with step parent and independent adoptions, program code R and 0 are not appropriate. So just understanding the difference, and if you have questions, you know, you can reach out to me or Caleb, and we can help guide you in the right direction. So there are some special considerations to think about for our 4E kids when they are in foster care. We have to look at these things, because these are things that will change a child that is 4E and how you claim. So for our child home placements, when the court has ordered the child home with the parent who they were removed from, in order to claim to 4E, if you have a 4E child, the child must be in that placement, in that child home placement, for a full federal quarter in order to claim. So that means every day for the full quarter, they have to be there. And so what we advise is you may want to claim to state, or you may want to claim to V or some other code other than Z until you can determine that that child has actually been in that placement for the entire time that they're supposed to be there. So it's going to take looking at the day sheets, going back, and then reclaiming if the child has been there. So just keeping that in mind, because it could be the difference between having a payback or leaving money on the table. And so when you have trial placement, you want to make sure that you're kind of keeping that on your radar to make sure that the child actually is there for all the days. When a child is with an unlicensed relative, you cannot claim the Z unless the child is with a relative who is in the process of becoming licensed. So they have 12 months to get licensed. And during that 12 months, you can claim the Z for the child. But after 12 months is up, if they have not gotten their license, then you have to choose another appropriate code to claim to. Runaways is another situation where you can claim to Z as long as the agency is making efforts to find the child, to have PPAP meetings, have CFTs, going to court, continuing on the case, and still making reasonable efforts. And I will say, like, we recently saw a case where a county had a runaway, it was pulled for monitoring, and the county just continued the case. They continued the hearing rather than actually listing out everything the agency had been doing in order to try to find that child or address the needs for this child. And that was not an appropriate court order in the sense of, like, we could not allow the 4E because there was nothing in there. Like, it just said we're continuing. And so that went on for several months. And so there was a lapse in the reasonable efforts language. So just keeping that in mind that you can claim to Z if you are actually doing the things that are required. So when children are placed in a hospital or acute setting, There's a couple of things here where if your child was in a licensed facility for at least one day of the month, and licensed, I mean like a licensed foster home or group home, then you can claim the entire month to 4E. So if that child was on day one in a foster home and then day two, they go to the hospital or to PRTF, you can still claim the remainder days of that month, the remaining days of that month to 4E. After the month is up, if they're still, like, you know, in the hospital or if they're in PRTF, you've got to pick some other funding source. Typically, we see B as the option to claim to. Safe surrenders, those children, because of the new law, they will never be considered 4E because they're not coming in by way of non-secure orders. If they are a true safe surrender by way of they're being given to like DSS, hospital, fire department, police, and the agency is not in fact following a non-secure, but they are getting the child and it's the child is vested with the department. And then I think like a month later or so within that time frame, the department files a motion in order to like establish some custody documentation to get a birth certificate. Those cases are not 4E eligible because the child did not come in. There's no contrary to the welfare language. So that in essence knocks them out of 4E. It also knocks them out of eligibility for adoption assistance too. So just keeping that in mind, if you have a true safe surrender that comes in, where they are just given over and the department does not file a non-secure, then those children are not going to be eligible unless they meet some other criteria like their SSI recipient. They are not going to be able to get adoption assistance. And that's any adoption assistance, not 4E, but any of it. And so the last thing we have here is 4E and SSI. And so the rule with this is children who are SSI recipients typically are 4E eligible. I've seen maybe a few that are not, and it's typically because the parents, maybe they make way too much money, and that sort of doesn't make any sense if they make too much money. But the threshold is really low when you think about the need part of our 5120 and documenting that. So it's possible, but for the most part, SSI recipients are going to be 4E eligible. And how we would claim this is they are eligible to be claimed under Z or Title 4E, if they are in a reimbursable placement, the issue with 4E and SSI is if the agency is receiving the check, the benefit check for that child, that check must be applied to the cost of care. And then anything that's over the amount of the cost of care that the SSI check does not cover, that must come out of state funds. So understanding that you can claim your administrative time to 4E, but anything over the amount of that SSI check cannot be claimed to 4E. It has to come out of state funds. There is the option to suspend the SSI payment up to a year without having to requalify. That would be something to really consider, like, you know, what's the long-term plan for this child? Is it beneficial to stop the payment? You know, what is the reunification plan? Just looking at all factors before you do that. So what about monitoring services and child welfare? So this has come up, you know, when kids leave foster care, the court sometimes orders DSS to continue monitoring a case until the next hearing. So 109 is no longer appropriate because the child's exited care. So what we suggest, what is the most appropriate to claim at that point is going to be 390, which is other child welfare services. Because within that definition, it does talk about court reporting, going to court, and monitoring in a sense of a case for a child that is receiving child welfare services. So if you have a situation where child exits and exits, like they can, grandma can be given custody, mom, dad, someone other than DSS has custody. And that's the difference, is that it's not a trial placement anymore. DSS no longer has custody. So you would look at 390, and then you would want to look at what the appropriate funding codes are. Are you going to look at permanency planning, TANF, MOE? And then 23, I think, is also an option there for certain cases. And then some of these other ones like COM, that's a 4B2 fund, and it is limited by funding as well as the child's age. So just understanding that not every code can be claimed for a 390 case.
So I'm very briefly going to go over using MAC and child welfare. this is not a comprehensive MAC training. I think there is going to be one of those coming up, and it'll be announced in the newsletter or the blueprint. We were asked to put this in here by a few counties. So MAC is Medicaid Administrative Claiming. And it's a set of codes that can be used when referring clients to Medicaid or discussing the use of Medicaid or Medicaid-funded services with clients. What is special about MAC is because it is effectively uncapped. So because so many funding sources are capped in child welfare, if you're able to use MAC, this can boost your county's reimbursement. So there's four MAC codes, and the first one we're going to talk about is 341, and this is facilitating an application for Medicaid. And you can use this code when you're verifying current Medicaid eligibility with a client, you're assisting the client with making a Medicaid application, or you're helping them to gather information and documents needed to apply for Medicaid. And there's no 5027 required for this. Next is 342, and you can use this when discussing with clients the importance of accessing mental health, developmental DD or substance abuse services, or explaining the Medicaid program. And that can include how to apply, how to use Medicaid covered services, et cetera. And for this one, there is also no 5027 required. 340, this is really the main MAC code we see a lot of counties using. And you can use this code when you're making referrals for coordinating or monitoring Medicaid covered services, when you're connecting the client with Medicaid service providers, or when you're coordinating with providers on a client's Medicaid care. And for this one, you do need to open them on a 5027, and you do need to verify that Medicaid eligibility is that they are receiving Medicaid. And finally, there's 343, which is arranging transportation services. And you can use this code when you're arranging or scheduling transportation to MA covered services. And again, you need to have them open on a 5027, and they do need to be eligible for Medicaid. And this code should not be used for the actual provision of transportation to clients. It's just for arranging it. So important reminders for MAC, the services do have to be covered under the state's Medicaid plan, and workers aren't expected to know everything that's covered under a plan, or if a client might need prior approval or anything like that. But for example, you couldn't refer them for cosmetic surgery or something that just isn't covered under Medicaid. For codes 340 and 343, like we said, you need to have the client open on a 5027 and verify that the client is receiving MA. And this could be as simple as documenting that you saw their Medicaid card, or if you have read-only access in NCFAST, you could document that you looked on their person page and they were receiving Medicaid, or that you contacted the income maintenance worker and verified it that way. And your documentation has to support billing for MAC, and we'll look at a example of that on the next slide. So one reason MAC can be a little tricky is because you have to break it out from your regular coding. Now, the thing is, if your workers are doing their jobs, they're already doing this work. They're already talking to your clients about their Medicaid, their mental health. So this is stuff they're already doing. And what matters is that they break it out in their day sheet. So in this hypothetical example, a worker visited with a family for 15 minutes. She discussed the child's mental health treatment with the foster parent. The child's in a relative placement and they're not 4E eligible. So in this case, the day sheet might look like 109V, 45 minutes, met with relative placement and discussed child's progress at school and visit with bio mom last week. And then 15 minutes to 340 MAC. Discuss child's therapy session and upcoming psychological evaluation with relative placement. And again, the documentation doesn't have to be, you know, extensive. It just needs to support the MAC coding enough that we can tell that it was related to Medicaid. So what are the impacts of incorrect day sheets? So the big ones are, if you have errors, it could lead to loss of revenue, audit exceptions and paybacks, creates incorrect data for your county. It can lead to decreased allocations next year. And that can all affect your workers in your county. You might see salary, you might not get a salary increase. You might see decreased benefit, supply, equipment cutbacks. The county might have to increase taxes to cover increased costs.
So what about monitoring? Monitors review appropriate eligibility determination forms that are included in the child's record. This is going to validate the initial and current eligibility for a period in the review. So this is what my team does. When you get those monitoring letters from me that says, guess what? We're going to be pulling a sample and we're looking at your 109 cases, or we're looking at your adoption assistance cases and other cases like that. Our team is going to be looking at day sheets 5094s, 5095s. We're looking at the 5120s. We're also looking at other documentation, such as court orders, the case plans, things of that nature, to make sure that the appropriate eligibility determinations were made. And the monitor will then document on their instrument the outcome and what was determined, if there was any erroneous payments made or claiming that was inappropriate, or if the county did something really well, they'll also document that and let you know. So there'll be interviews and meetings with county staff to discuss the monitoring. So creating errors for funding, it is never appropriate to just flip funding. And what I mean by that is if you have a situation where you find an error, you're doing an internal review and you're like, man, we got this wrong. We claimed on our 5095, we claimed a gap, and we should have claimed to adoption assistance, and this is a mess. Like, we've been claiming this for 2 years now. It's never appropriate just to flip that 4E funding, if it was 4E, just to flip it over to 4B and change it to the right source. That's not appropriate. It doesn't fix the problem. You still have an issue, because if the child is eligible for 4E, like, you're leaving money on the table, but then you're also claiming from like a source that the child's not eligible to claim from, really. And so it's not appropriate to do that. What you should do is you have to correct the issue. And so that may require having hearings. It may require getting documentation signed in order to correct the actual problem. Then you would need to request reallocation of funds and possibly a recoupment or repayment to the state office, to the controller's office. Federal funding can be reclassified up to the last 8 quarters. Right now, we're in January 23. So if you happen to come across an error that you find where you maybe claimed a gap, should have claimed a adoption assistance, then we can change that funding over and reclassify it up until the last quarter that we can. So that would be January 23. If you start a claim in November of 23, or not November, but like November of 22, and there's like several months in there that are outside the 8 quarters, that is going to be all county funds, and the county is responsible to pay that back. And so if it is caught in monitoring, you would receive a cap and a par as a part of the concluding documents, the findings for that monitoring. And that would be a part of the reconciliation, is to pay back any funding that was claimed inappropriately. And if it's something that we can reclassify, we would document that as well in the cap, and we would get those adjustments completed. So some of those adjustments would be made with the LBL, like with your day sheets, through a 1571 for time, and then others, it may be that we would just work with the controller's office in order to get those completed. And for like foster care, you would have to work with Tina in order to reclaim or reclassify any foster care funding.
So let's talk about correcting errors. So really the goal should be that workers are making daily entries, supervisors are reviewing day sheets regularly, and errors can be fixed before the submission deadline, which is the fifth day of the following month. And corrections should always be keyed by the worker, not a supervisor or an admin. That is a federal requirement. Even if day sheets have been submitted, as long as that upload deadline has not passed, the month can be reopened for corrections and then submitted again. Now, once that deadline has passed, the last county submission is the official record. And so although you can reopen prior months in Information Inc., fixing it there, it fixes the documentation on your side, but the official record you sent to the state is still incorrect. So what do you need to do? So the practice we recommend is, if you have errors found in a closed month, have the worker print the incorrect entry or entries, indicate the errors by crossing out the wrong entry,
write in the correct amount of time, SIS program code, client ID, et cetera, have the worker sign the correction and have a supervisor sign off, and then place a copy of the correction in the client's file and provide a copy to fiscal staff. And what happens is fiscal staff will have to key these corrections on the 1571. If there's fiscal staff on here, these corrections can be keyed as soon as the new month is open in NC Corals, which usually happens a few days after the prior month is closed. And you can go ahead and print a report showing the corrections keyed, so you don't have to wait to key those corrections, so you can go ahead and close out your monitoring or whatever. Now, note, some errors don't affect the funding source, and so they can't really be fixed because there's nothing for your fiscal staff to change. So these might include errors involving 990G time, or if they only involve a service code but not a program code. In addition to monitoring, your county also undergoes a single county audit each year. This is performed by a outside entity, a certified public accounting firm, and these results get reported to your county commissioners, to the local government commission, and also to the state auditor. And your auditors can pull documentation to ensure charges to federal wards are accurate, and this includes day sheets. Next slide. So some common day sheet findings we see on single county audits are: one, no documentation and case record to support the day sheet coding. So you might have a client, you might have a worker, and they said they had a visit with a client that day on their day sheet, and in the case record, there's nothing to support that. That would be an issue. We also see a lot of cases where day sheets are not matching the timesheet. A lot of times this is related to overtime. So counties aren't reporting overtime, they're not recording sick time, et cetera. Your day sheet has to match your timesheet. I know in the past, a lot of counties, you were working exactly 480 minutes. You had a set amount of time every month and every week. But now a lot of places are working flex schedules. Your day sheet needs to match your timesheet. And then another one is supervisors not reviewing workers' day sheets. When supervisors click that button saying that they certify their workers' day sheets every month, that's a signature, that's an electronic signature saying that they reviewed it, and they're attesting that those workers' day sheets are correct. So supervisors need to review their workers' day sheets. So what happens if you do have a single county audit finding? Well, you could have paybacks. Like we've said, day sheets serve as the basis for reimbursement, and any finding could lead to a payback. You will definitely have a corrective action plan, and this will usually involve some time-consuming and burdensome quality assurance processes, and you'll probably have to sit through some more day sheet trainings. One thing we get asked a lot is, what is the fiscal impact that this has on counties? So counties are reimbursed based on the actual and salaries and benefits paid to staff. The exact reimbursement depends on the day sheet coding across the entire agency. Counties are not reimbursed on any kind of per client, per hour, or per service basis. Counties also get reimbursed for overhead. This includes supervision, administration. It also includes non-personnel expenses. These could be things like supplies or costs of space like rent, building maintenance, et cetera. And costs get distributed out to different funding sources based on direct workers' day sheet coding. So this is a real example. It came from a child welfare monitoring a couple years ago. And in this case, the workers had coded a foster child to 109V, which is TANF to SSBG. Now, it turned out this child was 4-year eligible and they should have been coded to Z. TANF to SSBG is, of course, a capped funding source, and the county had exhausted their quarterly allocation. So all the time was going to 100% county funding instead of to uncapped federal funding. In the first month review, the one worker had coded 1,140 minutes to the child, and that led to $1,383 charged to all county costs based on the worker's salary and benefits. An additional $600 in overhead was cost allocated to this all county cost based on the coding. And in total, in that 1 month, the county lost $990 in federal uncapped revenue. Over the course of 12 months, there were 10 total workers coding over 20,000 minutes to this case. The estimated cost and salary and benefits was $13,000 plus an additional $5,657 in overhead. So in total, in that 1 year, the county lost over $9,000 in 4E revenue, and that was from one child in one case. And there were actually multiple children in this case. So it was, the cost from this one case was actually greater. Now, back in the spring, there was a change that allowed workers to code pre-service training, the new redesigned pre-service training, to 4E. And like we've said, 4E is uncapped funding. Typically, your training time gets coded to 990G, and it'll get distributed all across child welfare sources. And so most of those are going to uncapped sources. So being able to code the pre-service training directly to 4E is a big benefit to counties. Now, to do that, there are a few hoops y'all have to jump through. So to receive federal approval to direct charge the training time, the state did have to agree to a coding breakdown for a typical 480-minute day. So in this case, the typical breakdown is 395 minutes to 255 ET, 15 minutes to 255 Z, and 70 minutes to 255 N. When a workday is more or less than 480 minutes, there is a pre-service training calculator spreadsheet we've sent, and workers should use that. Pre-service training includes travel time, and it also includes the self-directed online part of the curriculum when the worker's back at the office during the week. If the worker's absent from the training, they should enter 990G like normal. And note that only the pre-service, the new redesigned pre-service, is currently eligible for this coding. All other training needs to be coded to 990G. When a worker has not completed pre-service, they cannot code to direct client services. So state law requires child welfare workers to complete 72 hours of pre-service training. This is in general statute, before they have direct client contact. And direct client contact means workers can't be alone with a client or assigned primary responsibility for a case. Prior to pre-service, however, new workers can assist their peers with things like documentation, making referrals to services, transportation, or observing family visits. So how should workers code that time if they have not completed pre-service yet? If they are doing supportive work, they should code to 752 ADM. This is what's called an administrative code. They don't need to break out the time necessarily. They can put it all in one big chunk. If they're doing transportation, they should use codes 251 and 252. Those are the codes for transportation to CPS and foster care. And they would need to work with the caseworker to determine the eligibility, the program code they should use. They should not use codes like 210, 211, 109, or other codes that require direct client contact. Now, one situation that has become common across the county, the state, unfortunately, is foster children staying in DSS hotels and hospitals. And a frequent question we find is, or we get, is how should workers code this time? So the first thing we need to do is look at the distinction between case management and sitter time. So case management, as defined in the SIS manual, is things like referral coordination to other services, communicating with medical staff about the child, seeking placement, updating case plans, prep for court or transportation to school, therapy, etc., as part of a service plan. Sitter time is things like providing regular daily care, sitting with the child while they're eating or sleeping, or playing with the child, watching TV, or entertaining the child. And we're not saying these things aren't valuable or they aren't difficult. They just don't meet the definitions in the SIS manual. So when a CPS worker is sitting with a child and they're providing case management services, they would code it to their regular SIS code for the activity and child. And this does have to be documented, obviously, and the documentation has to support what they're doing. If they're sitting with a child and they're not providing a service or activity that meets the definition of case management, they would code that time to 990G. Now, if the employee can do other work during this time, such as documentation or case management, et cetera, for other cases, they would code this time like normal. If you have non-services staff doing this type of work, if they're sitting with a child, they will need to code to 752 ADM. This is that admin code again, and this is because CPS supervision is ultimately responsible for that child, and coding that worker's time will make sure that the cost gets allocated to children's services codes. Now, if the worker can do other work and NC Fast or ACTS while they're sitting with the child, they would use their regular SIS codes. If you have an employee like child support or admin, and they don't regularly keep a day sheet, they'll either need to keep a day sheet for that month utilizing that ADM code or track their time in some other audit-worthy manner so that fiscal staff can make sure it's reported correctly on the 1571. Now, if at any point an outside entity like an LME MCO is paying for that worker's time when they're sitting in a hospital or in DSS, that time needs to be coded to an end code. And what I would suggest is to reach out to your local business liaison if you find yourself in this situation.
All right, so we're gonna test your knowledge and we're gonna walk through a few different scenarios here with our social worker who is new. We have Sally. She's new to DSS. Sally must attend pre-service training before she can receive her first caseload. So we're going to walk through a few months, really a few days of Sally's day sheet entries as she's beginning her work at the XYZ County DSS. So Sally's attending the new redesigned pre-service in the first month of employment. She can claim the time directly to uncapped federal for refunding during this time period. So this is an example of what her time, her day sheet would look like. So on Monday, Sally spends 2 hours traveling to pre-service. She then spends 7.5 hours in training, and her day sheet for that day should read as follows: 255 ET, which is the enhanced training for pre-service, to 470 minutes. Then we have 255 to Z, which is just standard 4E, 20 minutes for that. And then we got 255 N, 80 minutes. From Tuesday to Thursday, she's in training for 8 hours every day. Her day sheet should read 255 enhanced training at 395 minutes, 255 4EZ, 15 minutes, and then we've got 255 N at 70 minutes. On Friday, she's sick and she misses class. So her day sheet should read 480 minutes to 990 G time. So Sally's done with pre-service and she's given her first assignment, her first caseload, and she's working with the Smith family. So on her first week, Sally's worked with the Smith family for every day. Thursday, she covered intake, and this family consists of three children and a single mom. The case was found in need of services and placed in 215 in-home due to the oldest child Robert's mental health needs and some housing concerns for the family. It's a moderate risk case. There's a lot of concerns about Robert and his mental health needs. So Sally completes the case plan with the family, with mom, on week one. So Friday of week one, she completes her case plan. So her day sheet is going to look like, should look like the following. So week one, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, we're splitting the time between the children, between Alice, Paul, and Robert. We have 120 minutes allocated to Alice and Paul, and Robert, who has, you know, higher needs, so there are more collaterals being called or other folks being called for Robert. So she's spending a little bit more time on him, and then she had some 990 G time in there for an hour. Then Thursday, she spent all of her time on intake, so that would be 211R. And then Friday, we have our 215Z, where we're claiming the Title 4E because we have our case plan. There's imminent risk statements written in there. So now Sally can actually claim these children to Title 4E as candidates. Sally's worked with the family and in-home every day for a week. When she captured her time with each child, she did some general admin to cover intake as well, and then she had her general administrative time. Case plan was completed, and then she was able to start claiming for candidacy at that time on Friday. So week two, we're still working with the Smith family. In a perfect world, Sally's only got one case so far. So on her second week, she's still got the same family. And during week two, there's an incident that occurs where Sally ends up having to file a petition and a non-secure order on Robert. She files a non-secure and petition, only removes Robert, and this occurs on Tuesday. And the allegations were that he was shoplifting, that he was beating up his younger siblings and threatening to seriously harm them and mom. Additionally, he was refusing to go to school. He's missed 15 out of 35 days. And so there's a contrary to the welfare finding included in the removal order, because Sally uses the new non-secure order, the new J-150. And so the judge found that the agency had made efforts to prevent removal, because she had been working with them to prevent removal during the in-home. Even though she had only worked with them for a week, that still counts. Alice and Paul are not removed. They are still open to in-home. And so when Sally's trying to determine what this child's eligible for, she has to consider that all the income, the need and deprivation, and she would document that on the 5120. So we have mom, who is an SSI recipient, and she also is receiving SSA. So she's getting SSI, SSA, and then Robert and both children are also receiving death benefits, SSA, from their father, who is deceased. Robert is placed in a licensed group home, and Sally has also, like for this entire week, she specifically worked on Robert's case every day and split some time between Alice and Paul. So based on the information that we know, Sally has worked specifically on Robert's case every day for 1 week and split time between Alice and Paul as well. When she completed her 5120, she did that on Wednesday and determined Robert to be state foster home funds. So he's not 4E, and that was because the family was over the income limit. Even though mom was an SSI recipient, they still had a family assistance unit of three, and the income was well over because SSA is countable income. So on Thursday, the 7-day hearing was held. home visit with Robert at the group home was conducted. And Friday, there was a CFT case plan completed for Robert and the family. And so there was also a home visit with Alice and Paul. So her day sheet would look similar to this as, it, you know, if this is the only case, and we're assuming that this is how we would document that she's spending this time with these kids Monday through Friday, splitting her time with Alice and Paul, each 120 minutes, Robert's at 240, and Robert's still in-home on Monday. Tuesday's when we file the petition and non-secure, so that's when he switches over to 109. And so then on Wednesday, she's completed her 5120, so we would use 101 as the claiming coding for that, and as well as the 109. We also have in time with Alice and Paul, and then Thursday we have 128, which is court, and then we have 118 for Robert, which is the home visit. And then she's also worked on this case with case management duties like documentation, getting that case plan together, court reports, things like that she's documenting specifically for Robert. And then on Friday, we have time split with Alice and Paul for their CFT 219. Then we have Robert, who has his CFT, and then Alice and Paul with some case management as well on their case, and then she has some GTOM in there. So that's kind of the end of like our scenarios and what we would kind of envision, like if Sally was working, that's kind of what her day sheets would look like. So we're gonna open up the floor for questions. I know that there's been some questions here. So I'm gonna ask Jay if you would kind of go through what we've got to see how we can answer those.
Yes. You may be going to cover this later, but a review of the 14-day maintenance payment change versus how to code the day sheet. If the child is IVE, then day sheet coding remains IVE, even when the maintenance payment is limited?
Judy, I can only assume that when you're talking about the 14-day maintenance payment versus how to code on a day sheet, and the changes of that would be if a child is in congregate care, because with congregate care for a 4E child, and again, I'm assuming, because that's where the 14-day kind of comes in, is if a child is in congregate care, FFPSA does not allow, Title 4E does not, it will not allow Title 4E to be claimed more than the first 14 days. And then you can still claim your administrative time, but you cannot claim your actual maintenance. So your administrative time can be claimed, but like the room and board maintenance payments cannot be claimed to 4E after that 14 days has expired.
Thank you. What code would I use for transporting children and supervising visits between parent and child?
So if it's for CPS and foster care, you would use either 251 or 252, and I don't remember off the top of my head which is CPS and which is foster care. For supervising visits between a child, like for with a child, that would really depend on what the worker's position is, because there's a couple different codes you could use. You could use, if you're the caseworker, you could use 109. If you're like a support staff, you would probably use, I think it's 333, the paraprofessional code. And then if you are if you have a completed pre-service, like we talked about in the presentation, you would use that ADM code.
Thank you. If we get an out-of-state courtesy, but we are not involved other than the assessment check-in, what do we code?
I would say if you're involved like for assessment, then you would use a 210 code. You would have to open them up on a 5027.
They added, and the children do not have a SIS number.
Yeah, you would have to give them one in order to claim for them.
Thank you. Did you just say that a supervisor correcting a day sheet for a worker is a crime? We have our workers make corrections, if possible, but if not, then the supervisor has been told to correct it. Also, what if a worker is out on FMLA? They cannot fill out day sheets while out on FMLA.
It's not a crime, but federal regulations say that only a worker is supposed to enter or alter their day sheets. So if a worker is not able to, for whatever reason, they're on FMLA, they, you know, quit suddenly, whatever, you know, a worker could, a supervisor, my advice would be a supervisor to print that day sheet, to write the correct information, and to provide that to your physical staff to correct. But I would not alter it directly in Information Inc. or whatever your day sheet system is.
Thank you. When do we use 215N? Can you give examples? Thank you.
I must have just responded privately. So 215N, an example would be if you have an undocumented youth, that would be an example when you would use ENCODE.
Thank you. If the agency is closed, do workers put time in on day sheets?
So if the agency is closed, the SIS manual says you do not need to enter time for that day.
Do those 72 hours include the first week when they are online? I don't know if you have enough context for that question.
I assume they're talking about the pre-service requirements. I would have to do some research on that question because I do not specifically know the answer to that.
Can two staff claim 1094 AHV in which both the SW went to that home together?
If they're both there, there's nothing against them coding to that.
Why the change from 9 to R?
Well, and I think I just answered that, like, in the scenario, there wasn't a change. It was just, this is a possibility of how this could look. It's not a definitive, like, this is what it is. So, I mean, this was just an example.
And can 101Z be used for the initial 5120 determination for Robert? For the time used to determine eligibility?
So that's something I need to research, but I think original guidance was given that you could, but if a child is not 4E, you really should not be claiming to 4E. And I believe that what we have in our current policy now is that you should be claiming anything to state until you've actually made a determination.
Thank you. How do we obtain a copy of the SSI manual?
I assume they mean the SIS manual. It's on the DHH website. I put a link. It's the very first thing in chat.
Is there a specific code that is used for going to court?
Yes. So it depends on what service you're in or what phase you're in. If you're in CPS or you're in 215, then there's a code for that. And then for the 109, there's a code as well. And I believe that was in the scenario that we had. There was the coding for, I think, Robert, where we went to court for him. And that was, let me see, that was the 128, and then I believe the case management is, I believe it's 229, but you would have to look it up in the SIS manual because I do not have that SIS manual memorized. I know quite a bit of it, but I would encourage you to review the SIS manual to get the specifics.
Thank you. You are stating not to switch between V and Z on day sheets, but if a child leaves the placement to an unlicensed placement in the middle of the month, what should we code when the change occurs? Should we still code to Z, or should we switch to V in the middle of the month?
So the example I gave was if you have a child who is 4E and they are in a licensed placement, 4E allows you to continue to claim for the rest of that month if the child has been in that licensed placement for at least one day. You can claim the rest of the month. The beginning of the next month, you should start claiming over to a different funding source other than 4E.
How would an interpreter code when accompanying a CPS SW on an investigation or in-home services activities?
I don't know, Caleb, if you know that, and I would wonder if that interpreter is just an administrative person. Are they another social worker? Because if they're another social worker, then you're going to want that social worker to claim social work time.
Yeah, so this would depend on several things. Like Beth said, it could depend on what the position is. So if you have an interpreter, like a dedicated interpreter staff, and they are like administrative staff and they support the whole agency, they might not code anything. They might use one of the 750 to 754 ADM codes. If they are in a different department, like if you're using a income maintenance worker, you probably use one of those ADM codes. There's not a dedicated interpreter code. So it would just really depend. If that individual wants to reach out to me, we can talk about it.
Thank you. A couple of follow-ups with the Z and V. If we switch between Z and V, do we change that for the payments and reimbursement?
I mean, it depends because, like, it depends on if this is a reimbursable placement. If it's a non-reimbursable placement, then you should, it depends on if, it's like a PRTF, you're not claiming any kind of reimbursement under your room and board. If the if it's an unpaid placement like a TSP, or if it's like a unlicensed kin or a fictive kin who doesn't get the like the half board payment, then there's not gonna be anything to change to for your reimbursement. So I think it just depends on the situation, like what you're actually doing and whether or not it's a paid placement or not. Because typically that's when you're switching over to a Z or a V for your claiming for your administrative time. And I don't want to put blanketed statements because then they're interpreted the wrong way. I would just say that you need to look at your SIS manual. You need to understand that if you have a pay, the reimbursement for your administrative time will coincide with your claiming your administrative time. So if the placement is unpaid, so it's not licensed by DSS, NCDSS, it's not a foster home, it's not a group home, it's a PRTF or a hospital or a fictive kin, then that's going to be kind of that's your driver to know whether or not you're going to be claiming to V. If it's not paid, then you can't be reimbursed administrative time to 4E.
Thank you. If we are completing a Ryan's Law visit, what should we code?
I'm assuming that would be a visit for a foster child. So I would say, depending on what setting, if it's in the home, then it would be like a 118. A face-to-face visit, if it's outside the home, is 117. So I think it just, you need to go back to the SIS manual and see what that definition is of how you should code for that. because there's not a specific code that says Rollins Law visit.
Could you provide all codes with examples?
And I'll let Caleb answer this too. I don't know that that's, I'm not really sure exactly like the context of that, like all codes, like, and what kind of examples you're looking for. If you're looking for the service code and the program code, like I've got to have some understanding of what you mean by that. And again, I would refer you back to the SIS manual because it does give you the definitions of the service codes and the combinations of like the physical sequencing of those and when you should use them. And Caleb, I don't know if you want to answer anything with that.
And I'll just add, I mean, there's several hundred service codes in the SIS manual. There's, you know, several dozen program codes, and there's, you know, thousands or maybe even tens of thousands of possible combinations. And on top of that, there's 100 different counties that do things 100 different ways. And the state tries to leave latitude for counties to, you know, adapt to their own county policies to a certain extent. So it's hard to give examples that could meet everything a county might want. And I know from the county side, that can be frustrating at times.
Thank you. What is the latest version of the SIS manual?
It's the one online. I don't know. Let me see if I can find a date for it. I can't see a date it was last updated, but if they go to the link online, that would be it. And I would always encourage counties to use the online manuals, not to rely on paper manuals, because they just tend, those paper manuals tend to get out of date quickly.
If we have a child that is in an unlicensed placement, in parentheses, fictive kin, and they have been in care for over 364 days, what code would be the move appropriate?
I would suggest probably B, but you know, if you, it's possible that you can use P, but V is what we see most often.
If we have an ICPC for a foster child, do we still open a SIS number, and how can we open 109 if we aren't providing CFTs, PPR, and other services?
I mean, I think you have to open up 109, and usually with a ICPC case, that's what is open. So they'll send over the 100As, and they'll also include in that the funding source of the child's 4E. That'll be listed in the documentation. But you would claim it the same as you would a regular home visit, even though you're not doing the case management piece of that case. That would be the home state's responsibility. But there's not really any other way that you would claim those visits other than the 109 or the 118 or the 117 code.
Thank you. Other than completing the 5120, are there any other activities that can be coded 101Z until the funding category is determined, 5120 completed?
And again, I'm going to say that 101Z, I'm not like landing there, because that you really shouldn't be claiming anything to 4E unless a child has been determined 4E. So I don't know if that was previous guidance that was given, that 101Z can be claimed. But I know that what we say now is that you should claim anything to state until you have made a determination.
How do counties account for completing courtesies for other counties if that county's SIS numbers are not input into the assisting county system?
They should put the SIS number in their system.
Thank you. When a staff person leaves the agency and has not completed anything on the day sheet, how should this be handled? Supervision should not create a day sheet for that.
Yeah, in this case, there's nothing that can really be done. They should document what happened. And it could potentially lead to an audit finding, but it would be a worse audit finding if they tried to enter information in for that worker.
If a child is in foster care and we grant guardianship to a relative, but must continue to monitor the case for another 6 months, we should use the 390 code?
Yes.
If we open a 210 for an ICPC, when do we close the 10 code?
I'm not sure. I would have to go and look at the SIS manual for that, but I don't know that it really gives anything specific as far as ICPC. I would think if you are doing a courtesy or something, or you're doing an assist, you would open it. Once you've completed what you're supposed to do, then you would close it at that point in time.
Should day sheets total 480 to include any leave taken that day? In other words, a day should not be less than 480 per day. Is that correct?
So that is the guidance we used to offer, and that will often be true, but it really depends on your schedule. So if, especially with counties that have flex scheduling, that might not be true. If you're working part-time, it might not be true. You should, in general, enter what you actually work, and if you're taking leave time to make up for hours, you should enter 990G to match that leave time.
Thank you. What code will you use when a foster care worker is transporting a child to a visit? We usually code 109 for travel and 117 for face-to-face contact with a child outside of the home. We will also include 118 if we saw the child in their home, had to pick them up or take them home.
I don't see anything wrong with the 117 if you're transporting them. Now, Caleb, you may be able to advise as far as a transportation code, or if you're taking the child, you know, to some other, like if you're taking them to a medical appointment, that might be an appropriate use of like MAC coding instead of like the 109 or the 117. You may be able to maximize those funds, but Caleb, is there any other funding codes?
I mean, there's the, I can't remember if it's 251 or 252 code they can use. The worker, if they're transporting the child as part of the visit or the case plan, you know, they can use 109, but, you know, somebody who's not a worker cannot use the 109 code. And some counties might want the workers to, you know, use the 251 or 252 codes just to better track the kind of services and what the workers are actually doing. So to a certain extent, it just matters. It would depend on the county and their preferences, and then also what the worker's position is.
Can we code Z if a child is placed in a PRTF?
No. So let me preface that with, if the child comes from a licensed foster home or a licensed group home, you can claim Z for the remainder of that month. So at the beginning of the next month, you have to start claiming to some other code besides Z while they are in PRTF.
Thank you. Another V or C, I don't know if you've answered this. Do we open a 109V or Z or an ICPC courtesy request?
It depends on what ICPC has sent on their 100As. If they should indicate what the funding source is for that child. If they're 4E, then you would do a Z. If it's, you know, state funded, then you would do V or some other code, but I would suggest V.
I have a specific question regarding the FC 18-21 program. Do we code transporting the young adult as 117 or 119? I want to make sure we are coding correctly.
I mean, you can claim, I think this is similar to the same question we just answered about transporting a foster child. Same thing here with 18 to 21, because they're considered in foster care, so you would still use the foster care codes.
When you close out a 210 case and close it out on the 5027, what code would you use when you are finishing documentation, forms, letters, etc.?
I think we got this question on the last webinar we did. And before we give an answer, Beth and I'll discuss that at chat to make sure we're giving a consistent answer, but it'll be in the FAQ we publish.
What does APS staff code when assisting CPS with sitter services or case management?
If it's sitter services, they would use 990G if they're actually doing like sitter services. If they're doing actual case management and they've done, you know, some APS staff have been through child welfare pre-service, they could code to the case management code. Otherwise, they would code to 990G.
Is there a max number of codes for a child?
I think the question would be like what codes are appropriate. So depending on whatever service the child's receiving is what the code would correlate to.
Can 011R be used for ICPC foster care home visits?
I'm not sure. That would be something I'd have to research.
When is program code P typically used in foster care?
Caleb, you want to explain P?
Yeah, so P is permanency planning, and it has its own eligibility requirements. You know, I think the general eligibility requirements, so they have to be in care 12 months or less. Their plan has to be permanency. I think if they're in care over 12 months and their plans to guardianship with like an identified relative, you can also use it. But you can use it for case management. And this would be a code you use for your non-4E kids. And this is anytime you're working with those non-4E kids, I would really recommend your program staff work with your finance staff, because there's several different pots of money you can use, and you want to make sure you're maximizing those while still maintain the eligibility guidelines.
I was not aware that supervisors could not make corrections for staff. Is there something I need to do to correct my error last month's day sheet?
I mean, there's nothing you can really do to undo what if you've already done it. Just, you know, change your practice going forward.
What code would you use for completing all DSS forms when entering a child in foster care?
So it depends on which actual service you're doing. So if you're completing a 5120, then you would want to do 101. If you are filing petitions, non-secures, that might be where you're doing a 210. It just really depends on what you're actually doing in the forms. You know, if you're looking at foster care type forms, like those family, like finder forms and things like that, that'd be like a 109. So that's case management. And then CFTs have their own coding.
How do we code our 18 to 21-year-old children?
There's not a separate 18 to 21 code. Now, if you're doing link services, there are specific links codes, but otherwise use the same foster care codes you would usually use.
Our interpreters are now required to complete day sheets and are now under IM supervision. Do they code 752-ADM for in field or in home interpretation services?
So this could really depend on how the county's set up. That person can reach out to me, or they can reach out to their assigned LBL, and we can talk them through this.
If a child in foster care is determined to be P, do they remain P, or do we have to change them to V once they have been in foster care over 12 months?
I mean, if they don't meet the eligibility requirements for P anymore, you wouldn't be able to use that.
Beth, are there any more dates for this live training? If so, what are they?
We haven't scheduled anything yet, but we are going to be trying to get some dates together probably for like first of the year. Yeah, just be looking out for links and dates in the blueprint.
And then they would like to have the trainer's name. If you want me to, I'll go to the last slide.
Yeah, that's great.
And last slide, you can see the contact information for Beth Riley and Caleb Hawkins. We do have another question. Are FC 18 to 21 children able to be coded Z if they were determined to be IV-E when they were under the age of 18, or is there another code that we need to use for them?
So you would have to determine eligibility for the 1821 youth by using a 5120E. So once they sign a VPA, then you would be required to do a 5120E. It's basically a new entry. You would need to do a new 5094, so it's a new case. So old coding, old claiming is not the same from the minor case to the adult case.
I may have missed this, but will you send the recording?
The recording will be on the website, and once we get that, we will upload it. And if you want to reach out to me, I can send you a link. And I think, Jay, we were looking at sometime maybe end of this week or first of next, maybe getting it up.
Yes. A follow-up on the CIS number question. So does the child get a new CIS number in 18 to 21?
No. CIS number follows the child from beginning to end. The only time you would change a CIS number is if you have a situation where the child has been adopted and you're trying to claim like non-recurring adoption expenses, and those expenses have already been claimed for the like a prior adoption. That's like the only time that it's really permitted to change the CIS ID.
I think this is a follow-up add-on one of the questions. If they are in a non-leveled group home, can they still be coded Z?
If that group home is licensed and it's like a legitimate license placement, then yes, you can claim administrative time to Z.
A follow-up. Is this new? I have always been told the CIS does not change. This has been since the early 2000s.
It does not change. And like I said, the only reason why it would is if you have a situation where a child was previously adopted and you are trying to claim like non-recurring adoption expenses, the 5095 will not reset. So there's not anything we can do in order to do that, to change that. And so that's the only way you can claim it. But otherwise, the CIS IDs are to remain the same.
And Christine, you're requesting the policy link. Go ahead and, if you don't care, email Beth Riley. You should be able to see her email address on the last screen. Once a case is closed out via 5104 or 5027, how long can you use the code, if at all possible?
We'll put that in the FAQ we send out.
FC 18 to 21, if the child came from another county, would the new county need to request a new CIS?
No, you need to use the same CIS that the other county had. That way we can have consistency across the counties, and the child doesn't have multiple CIS IDs. And that's the reason why we don't change CIS numbers.
Is this training 990G?
Yes, you would code this training to 990G if you're completing a day sheet.
And that concludes our question set.
Thank you, Jay. So our contact information is on the screen. If you need to get in touch with us, feel free to reach out, send an email to me or Caleb, and we will try to get back to you as soon as we can. Caleb, do you have anything else?
Nope, just like to thank everybody for attending.
Yes, thank y'all for attending.
Thank you, everyone, and we look forward to seeing you in our future webinars. Have a great day.
Thanks, Jay.